So our second speaker is Professor Rupa Bandopadhyaya from Tadavpur University, and she will be speaking on the topic Mind and the Individual Ego, an analysis of the concept of mind from the Advaita perspective.
Okay. Namami Isham Ishana Nirvana Rupam Vibhum Vyapakam Brahma Veda Swarupam Nijam Nirgunam Nirvikalpam Niriham Chidakasham Akashavasam Bhajiham. First, I salute pure consciousness which reveals itself through the minds of all sentient and conscious beings, which is all pervasive, which is ubiquitous, which is Brahman itself, and which is Veda Swarupa, which itself is Veda, which is causeless, sui generis, which is not caused by any, caused by anything else, which is devoid of all attributes, which is indeterminate, not determined by any determination, and which is not located in space, which resembles Akasha in being all pervasive and permeating everything, but which is also the substratum of Akasha. I salute that pure consciousness. Then I salute His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama. I also salute Swami Atma Priyananda Ji Maharaj and other dignitaries present on the dais. I pay my regards to the respected and learned delegates. My paper is entitled, I also must express my gratitude to the Central Institute of Higher Tibetan Studies for inviting me here to make this short presentation before this august audience. My presentation is entitled The Mind and the Individual Ego, an analysis of the concept of mind from the Advaita perspective. As time is very short, today I shall be focusing mainly on the Advaita system. I shall draw your kind attention to some similarities and commonalities between the orthodox systems of ancient and classical India. Today, I shall not be speaking anything on the Nastika systems, that is the Buddhist, Jaino, and the Charvaka systems. I shall be concentrating only on the Advaita system and to the other orthodox, on the other orthodox systems. Although the Advaita Vedantins treat the Sankhya system as its principal opponent, yet we shall see presently that although the Sankhya Yoga systems are treated as Somana Tantra, yet there are important similarities, important commonalities among the Advaita Vedanta, Sankhya, and the Yoga conceptions of mind on the one hand, and the Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Prabhakara Mimamsa, and the Bhatta Mimamsa conception of mind on the other. The Sanskrit terms Antahkarana and Manas are ordinarily used as synonymous with the English term mind, although the Sanskrit terms are not used in the same sense in the Indian tradition as the term mind is used in the West. The West still to a large extent carries on the legacy of Cartesianism, where the mind is contrasted with matter and thought is taken to be the essential characteristic of the mind and extension is taken to be the essential characteristic of matter. But that is not the conception of mind which we find in the Indian tradition. The Sanskrit term antahkarana literally means the internal organ or the internal instrument of knowledge, the internal karana, where karana is usually defined as the asadharana vyaparavana karana, that is the uncommon cause of any effect which has an intermediate effect. While the term manas means the organ of manana or reflection. Now, I am classifying the conceptions of mind prevalent among the orthodox Indian systems into two groups. Please note that I am classifying only the orthodox conceptions, and I am not referring to the Buddhist conception of mind, the Jain conception of mind, and the Charvaka conception of mind in this presentation, because I do not have time to cover all the systems. Now, I am saying that two major conceptions of mind were prevalent among the ancient orthodox systems of India. The Naya Vaisheshika schools admit an infinite number of minds, each of which is atomic, anupadimana, indivisible, niravayava, which doesn't have any parts, eternal, nitya, and not constituted of one or more of the five elemental substances. That is, the mind is considered as abhautiko, non-elemental, by the Naya Vaisheshika systems. On this view, the mind is admitted as the internal sense organ, antarindriya, which is responsible for the mental perceptions of cognition, pleasure, pain, desire, aversion, and volition, the six internal states, the six perceptible qualities of the self admitted by the Naya school. The author of the Naya Sutra says, Yugapat Gyanan Utpattir Manaso Lingam, Naya Sutra 1116. Here, Maharshi Gautama establishes the existence of mind on the basis of the proverb that two cognitions are not produced, are not actually produced simultaneously. Now please note that we have five external sense organs, and the five internal sense organs can be in contact with its own specific objects together at the same time. The auditory sense organ may be in contact with some sound, and my olfactory sense organ may be in contact with some smell, and my visual sense may be in contact with some sight or some color, and all these contacts may take place simultaneously. But the Naya Vaisheshika philosophers are saying that all these five sense organs do not produce their own cognitions together or simultaneously. Why can't they produce their own specific perceptions simultaneously? The reason, because two other contacts are required for the genesis of a cognition in the self, and that is the contact between a sense organ and the mind, and the contact between the mind and the self. A cognition, a perception, is taken to be a guna, a property of the self. It's not an attribute of the mind, but a property of the self. Now, this provenance, this ground, says that since this contact between the mind and the sense organs is required, and the mind cannot come into contact with several senses at the same time, so at a time, at one point of time, only one cognition is produced. This same mark or province also establishes the anuttva, the atomicity, the nirabhayavatva, the simplicity, and the ekatva, the unitariness, the unity of mind. Why? Because if the mind has parts, then different parts can come into contact with different senses at the same time, and together five cognitions could have been produced. If there were many minds associated with oneself, if there were more than one mind associated with the same self, then all those minds can come into contact with the five sense organs, and many cognitions, many perceptions could have been produced. And if this mind were, if this had parts, then also the parts of the mind could have come into contact with the different senses, and many perceptions could have been produced. The Advaita Vedantins do not subscribe to this conception of the mind. And in many important respects, although the Advaita Vedantins are monists, the Sankhya Yoga systems are dualists, there are very important similarities between the Advaita Vedanta conception of the mind and the Sankhya Yoga conception of the mind. The Advaita Vedantins point out that the reason offered by the neo-philosophers for establishing the existence of the mind and its properties, anuttva, nirabhayavatva, ekatva, is a mere hypothesis and cannot be established as a fact. The Advaitins argue that there is also ample scriptural evidence in favor of the thesis that antahkarana is non-eternal. They refer to the scriptural statement, tan mano akuruto, that is, after the tanmatras, avidya created the samashti mano. The Advaita conception of mind directly follows from the main principles of Advaita metaphysics. The Advaita system admits a single reality which is called Brahman or Atman. This single reality is identified with pure consciousness. The Advaita Vedantins admit a very strict criterion of reality. On the Advaita view, an entity is said to be real if it is not falsified or falsifiable at any point of time, past, present, and future. The Advaita Vedantins establish this criterion by refuting the other criteria of reality admitted by the other systems of classical India. Since pure consciousness is devoid of all properties, cognition, pleasure, pain, etc., cannot be properties of the self. So, the internal states such as cognition, pleasure, pain, etc. are looked upon as transformations of the mind. But a thing, an entity, cannot have any transformation if it is simple or partless, because transformation or parinama is traditionally defined as avayava anyatha bhava parinama. That is, transformation is nothing but some change in the parts. This is precisely the reason why the Advaita Vedantins consider the mind to be a composite substance. The Advaitins put forward the following argument to prove the composite nature of the mind. They say that vimatam antakaranam savayavam. Antakarana is, the mind is composite, because it is a sadhidrabhyo, sadhidrabhatvat. It has a beginning in time and it is a substance, like a pot. The Advaitins differ among themselves regarding the issue whether the mind is a sense organ or not. The Vivarana school of Advaita Vedanta regards the mind doesn't regard the mind as a sense organ, while the Bhamati school initiated by Vachaspati Mishra regards the mind to be a sense organ. The Bhavati school says that in Srimad Bhagavad Gita, it is clearly stated that the mind is a sense organ. In Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Sri Krishna says, Mamai Vangsha Jiva Loke, Jiva Bhuta Sanatana, Mana Shashtani Indriyani, Prakriti Sthani Karshati. So the mind is the sixth among the sense organs. The Advaita Vedantins point out that this statement of Gita doesn't by itself establish the sense organ, establish the thesis that the mind is a sense organ. It has to be accompanied by an invariable concomitance, a vyapti niyomo, and that is yat yadgata sankha purakam tat tat jatiyam. That is, if anything has to fulfill the number of some another set of objects, then that has to be of the same kind. But the Advaita Vedantins have pointed out that this invariable concomitance, this Vyapti Niyomo, has exceptions. It is often said, Mahabharata Panchaman Vedan Adhyapayamasu. Maharshi Vadarayana taught the four Vedas and Mahabharata to his five disciples, to his disciples. Now Mahabharata is fulfilling the number of the Vedas, but no one will regard Mahabharata to be of the same kind as the Vedas. Mahabharata is Itihasa and the Vedas are regarded usually as Apaurusheya. The Advaita Vedantins show that the thesis that all internal states are transformations of the mind is also supported by the scriptures. The scriptural statement which they refer to is Kama, Sankalpa, Vichikitsa, that is all these states, Sarvang Manoevo. These are all mind. These internal states are revealed directly by pure consciousness itself in its capacity as witness consciousness. In fact, the Advaita Vedantins do not subscribe to the Nayo thesis, the Nayo view of perception, where the issue whether a particular cognition is perceptual or not is settled by the nature of the korono or the instrument by which the cognition is produced. So whether a particular cognition is perceptual or not doesn't depend on the instrument of the cognition. It depends on the object of the cognition. The Advaita Vedantins believe that the perceptual character of a cognition is determined by its object. If the object is superimposed on pure consciousness by the relation of identity, then it can be directly revealed by consciousness. So it depends whether the object is in direct contact, is in somehow directly related to pure consciousness. Then pure consciousness in its capacity of witness consciousness can directly reveal the object. So it is pure consciousness alone that is immediate, that is aparoksha. So the Advaitins define pratyaksha prama as pratyaksha prama chatra chaitanyam eva. Now, but pure consciousness cannot do this without the assistance of the mind. For pure consciousness, even though it is all-pervasive, doesn't have any relation with any object whatsoever. It is asanga hi ayam purusha. It is unrelated, so it's not related to any object. Besides, the object consciousness, the object which is superimposed on consciousness, is covered by the principle of nations since beginningless time. And unless this covering of nations is removed, pure consciousness cannot reveal the object. So the mind is indispensable for the genesis of the perceptual cognition and also the various forms of mediate cognitions. The mind also plays a very important role in distinguishing the subject consciousness from the cognition, the instrument of the cognition, and the object of the veridical cognition. That is, the pramata, pramano, prameyo, and pramiti are distinguished in terms of the mind. The mind also plays in distinguishing the various states, the four states of the individual self, namely the waking state, the dreaming state, the state of dreamless sleep, and the state of liberation. These states are not real stages of Brahman, but are superimposed on the self by avidya. In the waking state, the mind and the external senses are operative, but the external senses cease to operate in the state of dream. Only the mind remains operative. In the state of dream, the subject enjoys only the subtle objects created by the mind. These objects are called monomaya objects. The state of dreamless sleep follows the state of dream, where the mind gets dissolved in its own material cause. And in this state, the subject is not aware of its own individuality. So the mind is responsible for the individual's individuality. The mind also plays a very important role in Advaita soteriology. The Bhamati school says that the final immediate awareness of Brahman is produced directly by the mind as karana, as an instrument. Whereas the Vivarana school says that is not the case, because yato vacho nivartante aprapyo manusa saho, mind cannot touch pure consciousness, and the final immediate awareness leading to liberation is produced by tatvamasi, by the scriptural statement tatvamasi. An ascetic, a sadhaka with a purified mind, if he encounters tatvamasi, he immediately has the final immediate awareness of Brahman. So the mind plays a very important role in Advaita epistemology, metaphysics, and soteriology. I end my presentation here with my salutations to His Holiness.
Thank you very much, Professor Bandopadhyaya. And now we have time for discussion. Your Holiness would like to say anything or ask any questions?
Okay, it's on. His Holiness's question relates to the preliminary comments you made about that you are not going to focus on the Nastika, the traditions.
In today's lecture, because I don't have time.
Sure, sure. The question His Holiness has is that this distinction within the Indian darshanas, between the Astikas, the proponents of non-nihilism, non-existence and existence, so is that demarcation made on the basis of being non-theistic tradition, or is it because of the rejection of Atman? Or how is that demarcation, differentiation?
Yes, His Holiness. This distinction is based simply...
Jains, Nastikas. Yes.
No, I'm just clarifying the distinction. This distinction is based only on one principle, whether they admit the veracity of the Vedas or not. The Jains and the Buddhists and the Charvakas do not admit the Vedas to be a valid source of veridical cognition, because the Jains and the Buddhists do not subscribe to the Vedic rites of committing sacrifices. They adhere to the principle of ahimsa, non-violence. They do not subscribe to the Vedic practices of Pashubali, etc. That is why later on, when Lord Buddha was looked upon as an incarnate of God himself, Jayadeva said, Nindasi yagga vidheir ahashruti jatam sadaya hridaya darshita pashugatam keshavadhrita buddha sharira jaya jagadisha hare. This means that Buddha was repelled by Pashubali, by unnecessary shedding of blood. That is why he didn't accept the karmakanda of the Vedas to be a valid source of veridical cognition. This was the position of Lord Buddha. He never subscribed to the Vedic rituals and the Vedic practices. But he, of course, took elements from the Jnanakanda or the Upanishads.
Yes, Swamiji.
I have two observations only. Advaita per se, in the highest realm, the ultra-advaitic, the Gaudapada Karika, etc., they talk about mono-nasha, and they say the ultimate realization is when the mind becomes no mind, amani bhava. So Advaitins don't take mind seriously at all in that sense. Although later Shankara philosophers like you mentioned Mahamatikara and the Vivarana school. And second observation is, I think that statement which you made is slightly to be revised. The way the Jagrata, Swapna, Sushupti and Turiya, you said are states which are superimposed in the Atman by Brahman. I think that is absolutely unacceptable. Turiya is not a state, number one. And Turiya is clearly mentioned in the Mandukya Upanishad as the highest state where it is neither nanta pragyam, na vahi pragyam, na uvayata pragyam, na pragyanaghanam, na pragyam, na pragyam, adrishyam, avyaharyam, etc. So Turiya is not superimposed in the Brahman by avidya. I think that statement needs to be revised.
Sir, I absolutely agree with your observations. In fact, Madhusudana Saraswati, in his Gurartha Deepika, clearly states that even after Jivan Mukti, the yogin has to become a Parama Yogi. Unless there is Mononasho and Vasanakshayo, there cannot be Videho Mukti, because the Manas can assert itself and can again, it again can flee towards the external objects. Chanchalam hi manah Krishna. So this point is discussed in great detail by Madhusudana in his Gurartha Deepika. And that was a sweeping statement because of scarcity of time. These four states are called the Padas in the Mandukya Karika, in the Mandukya Upanishad, where the first three states has a different derivation, and the fourth state is a pada in a different state. The first three states are called pada in the sense padyate aneno iti pada. That is, the fourth state is reached through passing, by passing through the three states. So they are superimposed on Atman by avidya. But the fourth state, the Turiya, as you have rightly, very rightly observed, is padyate yah. That is that which is attained, that which is to be attained. So it is identical with consciousness. It is not anything superimposed. It is pure consciousness. It is nirvana rupam. I started with that benedictive verse that nirvana is nothing but pure consciousness. Brahma veda brahmaiva bhavati. Isn't it?
I think we're actually out of time. So we need to switch to the next group. And so I now relinquish my moderatorship to Professor Bhatt. And thank you very much, Professor Bandopadhyay.